So thank you very much for this opportunity. Thanks for the organizing to give me this opportunity. So today I'm going to speak about my research entitled "The Rock Mass Properties by the Stochastic Homogenization Method." I am Bushra Mejri, a postdoc researcher under the supervision of Professor Olivier Pons of the University of Côte d'Azur. And so this work is a joint work with him in the frame of the DEFIDEF project led by him and the ENR research project for Jumez, led by the director, scenario director Isabelle Magetti. Earth rocks and the man-made materials always contain defects coming in the form of small fracture of various yet small size, often hardly visible to human eye. Where the fracturing is dense, it modifies the mechanical properties of the rocks, and this modification can have critical consequences like weakening and even disruption of the materials, building walls, or container walls. And even we can find the leakage of fluids like water, radioactive elements, and amplification of the waves they may be crossed with during an earthquake. So while research in material science have well advanced our knowledge of the mechanical properties of man-made materials, little is known on the mechanical properties of natural fractures or earth rocks. So this study tackles this issue, focusing on the case of intensely fractured rocks around tectonic faults. The latter are those producing earthquakes, and therefore quantifying the physical properties of the rocks that host them is of utmost importance to anticipate their rupture behavior during an earthquake. So the objective of this study is to derive a mathematical model for fractured rock volumes around the faults, and this remains a challenge on the one hand because the natural fracture networks are dense and complex, and on the other hand because fracturing occurs over a wide range of specific scales from microfracture to largest faults. So to derive the elastic properties of the fractured rock masses, we modeled their overall mechanical behavior by homogeneous macroscopic equivalent medium, which is a small volume in which we assume homogeneous elastic mechanical properties. So what we can find in the empirical works is the work of Davy and his colleagues in 2018. They calculate the analytic solution for the effective properties for rock masses with which are modeled by a double power law for the length distribution, and for the orientation and the position are modeled as uniform distribution. So this is the outline of my speech. The first point is the statistical scaling model. The second one, I'm going to present for you the mathematical confidence modeling, and I'm going to finish my speech with numerical results. So the first point. So, which is the most important here that we need to know which parameter we are going to choose to describe the fault networks. First of all, here we are working in a map. So here it's the granite desk in Arizona, and we're going to focus on this map. The blue ones, which is this is the real configuration, the map 16, where we're gonna find the total number of mapped faults, 932, with the longest fault length is equivalent to the size of the medium, and the shortest one is the following. So here we're going to work with an idealized configuration, which is modeled by straight fraction. And we're going to try to develop a statistical scaling model with a finite number of parameters, and it will be simple enough for to be identified from field observation. So here we're going to focus our attention on the density, size, and orientation. So the natural fractured rock masses is among the complex system characterized by the auto-similarity, the statistical auto-similarity, and the wide range of scales from microfracture to largest faults. So here we're gonna focus on the to find the fracture dimension. So here we choose to what we can find in the in previous works that we two methods or two approach. The first one is the box counting dimension, and the second one is the spatial dimension. So for the first test, we're going to use the box counting dimension. So the box counting algorithm is based on the fixed grid scheme to examine the square box grid overlaid on the image. So more precisely, the scaling strategy consists of counting the number of boxes containing relevant pixel of the grayscale scale digital image at each scale. So the idea here is to calculate to calculate the ratio of the change in details to the change in scales. In other words, to calculate the number of boxes of with exponential size epsilon. And we can find that the scaling factor is expressed as follows. So, and here we so the box counting dimension is an exponent of power law. So what we're going to do is just to look for the log plot of the number of of the number of boxes containing parts of the image as the function of the scale. And the second line is the regression one, which we're going to specify the value of the box counting dimension. As we know, the box counting dimension takes values in the range of one in for the one dimensional and two for the two dimensional. Next is the spatial distribution of masses. So here the idea that we're going to study the fracture barycenters. So the quantified fracture barycenters are extracted from image analysis in situ, and here we plotted them in a map. So here we're going to use the same algorithm, but this time we're going to calculate the number of fracture barycenters at each scale, and we expect it to be more it will be more more precise than the box counting dimension. So the next parameter to describe the fracture is the length distribution. As we as I mentioned before, that the fracture the natural fracture rocks are characterized by the by wide range of scales from the microfracture to the largest faults. So here what we chose like distribution function is the double power law is the following one. So here n is the number of fracture having length in a specified interval, and dm is the mass dimension of fracture barycenters, which I calculated before. A is the exponent of the frequency distribution of fraction length, and alpha is the pressure density term. So the first histogram is the one plotting the fault length distribution from the experimental data. As you can remark here that the histogram is characterized with a long tail fault. And so for that reason, we choose this distribution. And the second one is the fault length distribution from the derived value. So the main advantage of this distribution that we can even estimate the most the numerous smallest fracture that we can't even extract from image analysis. So for the first one here, we have like 932 fractures, but with the derived statistical law, we found that here we have 1,621 fractures. The next, so the next parameter to study is the position distribution. The idea here that we're going to classify the fracture in two classes. So I'm going to show you. So as you can see here, this is the histogram for the length distribution from the experimental data. Here we can see that there is a discontinuity in the length scale. So we're going to consider this part as the parent faults as the largest one with the length larger than 0.24. And the remaining ones are the secondary fracture. So after this classification, what we're going to do, we're going to calculate the minutest this distance weighted by length from the parent faults. So we're going to just to focus our attention on the secondary fracture. And as you can see here, there is the histogram, which is characterized with a long tail form. And for this one, we chose the exponential commutative distribution function, which is more simple. Because here we have to find the one parameters, the rate parameters. And the second, the histogram showing the fault position distribution from the experiment, from the derived value. The final parameter to study is the orientation. So, we plotted the orientation fracture from the experimental data, and what we can write here that the orientation population are the orientation fracture population are characterized with the three subpopulation. So for this one, we have to work with the mixture of distribution, and we choose the Bormis's commutative distribution function, which is the following one, defined by the mean direction, the concentration parameter, and the Bessel function of the first kind at order zero. And we're going to find the parameters for a mixture of Bormis's distribution for 3-1. And this histogram shows the derived value. So it's a statistically confirmed fit with the experimental one. So the important for this study is to understand the impact of the numerous smallest fraction. For the first test we did it is we got to plot the fracture dimension as a function of the fault length. So here, as you can see, this is the histogram for the fault length distribution. And here we plot the fracture dimension as a function of the fault length. So at each time, what we do, we eliminate a certain scale of smallest fracture, and we calculate the fracture dimension. So as you can see that from that there is that the fracture dimension get values under one from fracture with length larger than 0.15. So it's very expected with if we compare it with the histogram. The other test we did that we plot the Rose diagram weighted by fracture length, just to understand the orientations of fracture with their length. So here, this is the histogram from the experimental data, and this is the Rose diagram, even from the experimental data, just to understand that the smallest fracture are the ones who more or who are perpendicular to the longest one. So this is the relevant information that we can use it for the algorithm to generate fracture. Now we have an algorithm. So now we are interested to generate fracture. So the first step, it will be to draw the parent faults from the experimental data. As we say, this we're gonna just consider the 11 first parameters. For the ones are with lengths larger than this value. And from now, we're gonna to calculate the number of fractures, the secondary fractures. So the first, the largest length for the secondary fractures, it will be from this value. And we so we're gonna to calculate the number of fractures by using the double power law as follows. And after that, we're gonna to calculate the total number of fractures with for each subdivision of the length. Here we are. So now we have the total number of fractures. So we're gonna to generate fracture by fracture. The first step will be to generate the length, which is following the inverse commutative the distribution function of the double power law as follows. After that, we're going to calculate its minutest distance from the previous one, which is following the inverse commutative distribution function of the exponential distribution multiplied by its length. And after that, we're going to generate the fraction. So the idea will be, at first place, we're going to choose an arbitrary fault among the previous one. So it will be the one which has the minutest distance from the generated new one, and we're going to choose another. We're going to choose an arbitrary point, which should be the orthogonal projection of the chosen fault. And after that, we have to choose which side it will be, on the left or on the right. After that, we already have all the information to compute the first fracture tip. So what we need is the second one. And for the second one, we're going to compute the orientation, which following the inverse commutative distribution function of the mixture of Venus's distributions. So now we see the synthetic fracture networks. So this is the first confusion. And the other ones are the synthetic fracture networks from the derived statistical laws. So here we used only the parent faults, and eugenics, the secondary faults from the derived statistical laws. And the difference between both of pictures that this one we only measure from image analysis 932 fracture, but for the other ones we have like 1632 fracture. So we have idea about the small one that we can't measure from image. The next step is the mathematical continuous modeling. So we're going to model our medium, the linear elasticity system, as follows. So the sigma is the Cauchy-Sayre tensor, which is given by the relation between the elasticity tensor and the strain tensor linearized, which is known as the Hooke law. And on the fracture, we're going to choose this kind of conditions. So this is the jump of the traction. The jump is, so it will be the difference between of a quantity between the boundary of a fractures. So we will have the continuity of the tractions, but the displacement is discontinuous and it's proportional to the average of the traction by stiffness parameters. This parameters is diagonal matrix as follows, which have two components in the tangential direction and in the normal direction as follows, which is known in the as the spring time linear law. So we can even find an explicit an explicit so an explicit expression for the stiffness parameters as follows. Here, h is the thickness of the between the boundary of the fracture, and mu and lambda are the parameters for the median between the fracture from the boundary of the fracture. So this is as direct problem is well known in previous works. You can find lots of people who works on this model, but as an inverse problem, what I already have found, it's only the work of Brian in 2009, which he works on the identification of the fracture and the reconstruction of the parameters for the Laplace equation. It was only for the plane fracture, and he used the reciprocity gap approach. So in my PhD thesis, I was interested in this problem, and I was interested in the stability estimates. So I already established the Lipschitz stability, which is based on a new Kalman inequalities for imperfect interfaces, and even I was interested in the numerical reconstruction of the parameters for the elasticity in 2D. But here the objective of this study is to drive the effective elastic properties of the fractured rock masses. So the idea here that we're going to use the stochastic homogenization method, that here our medium is stochastic. So it will be to this probability space, and we're going to reduce the model to micro problem as follows. And after that, we cannot to calculate the effective properties, and we're going to find this corrector problem, which is defined by periodic boundary condition on the external boundary of the set. So we are Actually, interesting in the macro problem, the following graph. So here, as you can see, that our domain, it's we don't have any more fracture, and all the information of fracture are in this effective coefficient, which is the homogenized Hook law, defined in this case by this expression. So the next question is to see the convergence of the homogenized problem. What we can find in the previous works that there is two cases, the periodic imperfect interfaces, which is well studied previously. As you can see that even with asymptotic analysis to scale convergence method, and recently for the elasticity system with the periodic unfolding method. But for the stochastic imperfect interfaces, we find only this work, which is the work of Heide in 2011, who studied the stochastic imperfect interfaces. It wasn't even for fracture, it was for a medium which is more, it's not that complicated, it's not as our case. For our case, already we have the challenge that we need to have good information on the behavior of fracture, specifically on the orientation of fracture, that to so we can prove that the homogeneous problem is we have the convergence of the homogeneous problem because if we are in the case where we have fracture, we have a lot of fracture that cut the medium in two, the homogenization process in that case fails. So it's so important for us to understand the behavior of fracture. The final point is the numerical results. So here for the first step that we begin with the 10 of fracture, as you can see here. So this is the centric fault networks. This is the deformation accommodated by the fault network in both directions. And here we calculate the effective coefficients. It's, in other words, it's the average of the effective coefficients. So with respect to the number of realizations. So we, as you can see that we already have a convergence between 350 realization and 400 realization. So the next question is the boundary conditions. As I mentioned before that we, it's natural to work with periodic boundary condition on the cell. But we can choose other conditions like the Dirichlet boundary condition, the following one. In this case, we have to calculate the effective coefficients or the Newman boundary conditions with this choice. This is the basis of for the elasticity system. So. And as you can see here, that we calculate the average of the effective coefficients for the three boundary conditions. So the red one is for the Newman, for the black one is for the periodic, and the blue one is for Dirichlet boundary conditions. So unfortunately, here we don't have the Hashimoto-Strickman bounds to. That case we can't compare our numerical results with analytic solutions, but we think that it's natural to work with periodic boundary conditions. The next question is the determination of the cell size. So it's important to know which size we have to choose for the cell. Here we find that, fortunately, we find this kind of relation, the relative error, which is related to the standard deviation of the effective coefficients and the number of the realization and the effective coefficients. So we can here plot the effective coefficients and the error, and from this plot we can choose which value of L we have. We can find the convergence estimation. So, as I mentioned before, that we the first time we worked only with like 10 fractures, but it's not our case. In our case, we work with 200 fractions. In that case, we begin another approach, which is based on the dual boundary integral equations, and for this one we we're going to use the conventional boundary integral equation on the exterior of the boundary of the domain, and the even on the in the upper of the fraction, and the upper singular integral equation as follows for the second boundary of the fraction, and we calculate. So we calculate the direct problem or the corrector problem for our case, and already it works for like 1,000 fracture. So it's not that clear here, but we already have lots of fractures which are so close. And what we already going to work on, actually I'm working on developing fast multiple boundary integral method, and we hope that with this method we can calculate the direct problem with 2,000 fractures. So until now we didn't answer the main objective of this project, which is Hawking defaults and fracture alter integrity of rogue and material volumes. So another order one, as I mentioned that the first in the first time we are working with this map, which have the parent faults with the secondary fractures. So the secondary fractures are considered as the damaged zones. The second map has only the parent faults. And for the geoscientist, that it's so important to keep the parent faults in the medium, and we only have to homogenize the secondary fractures. So this fractures, it's a part of the medium. We can't fracture. We can homogenize all the domain, and for that. For this issue, we already have an idea how we're going to work with this. So we have idea that we're going to combine the stochastic homogenization process with the multiple methods. So with this kind of combination, we can have an idea on the interaction between the parent faults and the secondary fracture. And after that, we need to know which is the scaling relation between the parent faults and their damage zones. So there is a lot of questions, challenges we have to deal with in the future. And even for the theoretical questions, we're going to study the convergence with the new derived synthetic fracture network. Thank you for your attention.